right, folks, welcome. Today, what are we going to talk about? Well, again, we got the wildfire smoke from California, terrible scene conditions, and a lot of light pollution. I haven't been able to drag my stuff out to a deep or dark sky site, and it's just kind of not worth doing planetary right now until maybe a little bit later in the season. So it's the season for tutorials, I guess. One of the things I'm going to talk about today is the Bayer matrix. What is that Bayer matrix? We see it all the time in discussions. Hey, what's the debayering matrix for this? What's the Bayer matrix? What's the CFA? That's another term called color filter array that is laid over the sensor. It's the same as a Bayer matrix. And it was designed and engineered by a guy who worked for Eastman Kodak, and his name was Bryce Bayer. And so it's named after him. In fact, it's been said by some experts in the field, some physicists and experts in digital photography, that had he not invented this, or at least someone down the line, digital photography like we know it today would not even be possible, because all our pictures would be in monochrome. You know, they'd be not necessarily black and white, in other words, black or white, zero or a one, but rather everything would be in monochrome, and there'd be no way to take digital color pictures. So it's pretty cool. So you see it in your processing software, even in planetary videos. For example, many of you use auto stacker, and there's a function in there where you can auto detect the Bayer matrix, or where you can force the Bayer matrix, force the demosaic or debayering, if that's the term you want to use, of your video. And so big picture, and I'm gonna draw the details here. But the Bayer matrix is a matrix that overlays your sensor so that we can gather color information from the data that we're collecting, from the photons that the sensor is absorbing. And that Bayer information is specific to your camera. Let me repeat that. The Bayer matrix is a physical filter, a matrix, a two-dimensional array of filters overlaid on your sensor. So it's camera specific. Now, well, let me take that back. It's really sensor specific, because the sensors come with the Bayer matrix installed on top. So for example, a number of ZW-ASI cameras have Sony sensors. Some of the cameras that are different models still have the same sensors. It's just different features about that camera that make the camera different. But the sensor itself is the same, so therefore it's gonna have the same Bayer matrix. And Sony, generally speaking, I believe they use RGGB, could be wrong on that, but I think Sony uses pretty much the same Bayer matrix on all their dedicated astrophotography cameras, to include planetary, so DSO and planetary. But when your camera writes information to your hard drive or wherever it is you're storing your data, or your little micro SD card, wherever your data is being stored, whether that's video or raw files from a DSLR, part of the information written to that file is the Bayer matrix that that camera has. And in fact, there are many programs out there and processes within programs, for example, PixInsight, which will show you what, when you go and inspect a raw file, it will tell you what Bayer matrix that raw file was used or is associated with that raw file, i.e. that camera. And when I go and process that raw file, the software, it's looking for header information in that raw file. Nothing to do with the image data yet. It's looking for the time, you know, exposure time, ISO, time of day that the picture was taken. By the way, time of day doesn't mean it's daytime. That is a technical term used to describe GPS time in our constellation of GPS satellites, called TOD, called a TOD for short. So it's looking for the TOD, and it's looking for the Bayer matrix information. Now it knows how to process that raw file for further on processing, and or just to display it on your computer screen. So let's talk about the Bayer matrix. But first, to talk about that, let's talk about the sensor in your camera. And this generally applies to all your DSLRs and your planetary cameras and your dedicated DSO cameras. For CMOS or CCD, generally speaking, this is kind of how they work. And if we understand how our sensor works, then we'll have a better understanding how the Bayer matrix tied to the sensor gives us color information. Then we'll have a broader spectrum and a little bit more depth and understanding what our camera is doing for us. And it may even lead to maybe some smarter post-processing when we understand the Bayer matrix in our sensor. So what's the sensor's job? Its job is to collect energy. I mean, really, that's what it boils down to, right? Some people say, well, it collects photons. It really doesn't. It registers photons. It knows when photons have hit it, but it doesn't collect photons. It really collects electrons. We'll talk about that here in a sensor. Second, so our sensor is a two-dimensional ray on our camera, and it has an X dimension and a Y dimension. In fact, we can talk about a specific pixel on that sensor, and it's an array of pixels, a whole bunch of them, could be a few million to 20 something million. I have a DSLR with over 20 million pixels on it. And how do we get that number? Well, we multiply X times Y, and that gives us our sensor size. You know, when you hear about 5 megapixels, 10 megapixels, well, you just multiply the two dimensions and that gives you your pixel size. In fact, we can reference any given pixel with a simple Cartesian coordinate system like you learned in high school geometry or mathematics. And guess what? We can talk about that specific pixel at coordinate X, Y for that Cartesian coordinate system. So what is a pixel? Well, pixel, P-I-X-E-L, is a term that stands in the old days during film, like in the 20s, you know, when they were making movies and stuff, you know, they'd say, hey, did you film your pics yet? That just meant, hey, did you film your motion picture? So pix is short. That's where that P-I-X comes from. And then L is short for element. So picture element. That is what pixel is short for. So our sensor consists of an X by Y array, two-dimensional array of these pixels. And the pixel itself, if we were to just kind of draw it as a square, actually has some depth to it. And this pixel consists of, in the world of electronics, consists of, you know, a couple AND gates, and, you know, if that's how you draw it, I can't remember, a couple OR gates. It also has a photo. This is the electrical symbol for a diode. It has one or two photoelectric diodes, meaning these are sensitive to light rays coming in, i.e. photons. And then these AND and OR gates, I think they're just AND gates. I can't remember. You guys can look it up. It doesn't matter for this discussion. But these components, and they're kind of hooked together. And of course, there's a common ground among them if you're familiar with circuitry. And then each of these can be pulled off in terms of looking at the results of these gates. But this right here is a pixel. And it's pretty amazing that they're able to shove all this stuff into a pixel that is 1 to 2 to 3 nanometers across. That's billionths of a meter in size. And you can look on your camera's specifications. In fact, I find when I have to go look up specifications of my camera sensor, I have to go find specifications on the camera, then where it lists its size, its weight, and hey, is it 2 inch or 1 1/4, etc. In there, it'll list the sensor used for that camera, and then it goes on and lists other stuff like price or whatever. But I don't get specific details on the sensor. It just tells me the type of sensor. Now, I go and I Google the sensor itself, and that's when I get the XY dimensions of the sensor. It tells me how many pixels are on that sensor, because just because the sensor is a given size doesn't mean that that size is totally comprised of pixels, right? There's other information or other stuff on that sensor for like mount, you know, to mount the thing and glue it. Plus some of that electrical circuitry that you saw, and most sensors sits on top in front of the pixels. So there's actually some light blocking that occurs. So if you look at the specifications of your sensor, you'll see that there's I think some specifications use an efficiency term. Some will actually give you an effective pixel count. So even though the array is X by Y, in reality, the light collecting data for that sensor is some number less than X and some number less than Y. And it'll also give you the pixel size. So it's pretty impressive. And pixel size can determine, sensor size, pixel size can determine the resolution of the objects that you're shooting, right? DSLRs have very large sensors. So if I take a snapshot of Jupiter or Saturn, they're going to look very small on that sensor, because Jupiter, the light from Jupiter and Saturn do not subtend a large number of pixels on that sensor. I take that back. They subtend a very large number of pixels in this array, but they appear to be small in my DSLR pictures versus planetary cameras. Small sensors, larger pixel size. That's why you can get larger planetary images from a dedicated planetary camera, i.e. using video, than you can a DSLR. So this is our pixel. And picture it now, in reality, obviously it doesn't look like that, but picture it as a box. And of course you got the bottom of the box here, And again, there's no rewards for artistry, so bear with me. So picture this three-dimensional box, almost like a shoe box with the lid on it, but it's turned on its end, and we've cut the end out so it can collect stuff. And picture a bunch of these on a table, and I throw ping pong balls in the air, and some ping pong balls land in them, some land on the edges and fall off, and some ping pong balls don't land in this box at all. But over a period of time, as I throw these ping pong balls in the air, over a period of time, they'll begin to collect in this pixel, in this picture element. And then I can stop throwing ping pong balls and then examine my array of shoe boxes and ask myself, in what pixels do I have ping pong balls? Now, the analogy there is that these are electrons that have been stored during exposure time. And now I can go and read each of these pixels. I actually technically read row at a time and read that data. And that gives me an idea of the type and number of photons that struck. And when I say type, I'm meaning energy level, right? Red, blue, green, purple, pink, whatever that color is associated with that photon. We'll talk about that here in a second. But I've actually now have a way to measure the amount of photons and their energy level that have struck any particular given pixel here. A lot of times when you look at the sensor information, it'll talk about well depth. And that's, it's like a water well. Is it 3 feet deep? Well, I'm probably not going to be able to collect or store very much water. But if the thing is 300 feet deep, then I can probably collect a lot of water. And certainly if I wanted to fill up that well, it will hold a lot of water. So same thing. One of the things you'll find in the specifications of your sensor is well depth. And that means how deep is this well? How much information can this thing collect and how much can it hold? So if I have a well that's very, very shallow, very, very shallow, and I do a 40-minute exposure, most likely I'm going to overexpose that pixel. In other words, whatever maximum value that pixel can represent, I've hit it. And what's that typically lead to? A white pixel. In other words, I've blown out all the data for that pixel. And of course, that happens across the image and I end up with blown pictures. So well depth kind of limits your exposure. Now, there's nothing in your like capture software that's going to tell you, hey, don't set your exposure this high because you're exceeding your well depth. You'll just know it because in post-processing, all your details will be blown out. So you either lower the gain or lower your exposure time. So that's what that well depth means right there. So let's erase this and draw our sensor to be more kind of this two-dimensional ray. And I'm going to draw it in three dimensions because I want to include those wells. And again, I'm not going to attempt to draw each of these in three dimensions, but you know what I'm talking about. We can do that, and then we got some that go across. It's probably, I don't know how that looks in the video. In fact, I can probably but do it a little bit bigger. But here's our wells, you know, here's our pixels, right? Across the top of our sensor is a very, very thin piece of material. Some cameras, advanced ones, use a kind of a metallic oxide type substance. Some use silicone, but just a silicone wafer, which has very unique properties. And I dope this silicone, which simply means I cover it. I paint over it. I dip it, whatever the process they use. I'm not the expert in this, but they dope it with, and it's called an N-type, if I can spell type, or I'm sorry, P-type or N-type. And our sensor, and then you'll see it's actually the sensor itself. These pixels are sandwiched between an N-type and P-type silicone. And what happens is because the silicone, if these were just two pieces of silicone, who cares, right? They're just two pieces. But because I've doped them differently, they react differently. And any electrons that I can free from this upper layer here, they will be attracted to this bottom layer. And they have to pass through the sensor to make that happen. Now, if you remember basic chemistry, so just remember that picture right there because I'm going to draw it again here in a second. And I'm going to do it to not such great detail. Not that that previous picture was that detailed. But if you remember from basic chemistry, you know, here's the nucleus of an atom and you got some electrons. You're allowed 2 in the inner shell. You're allowed up to 8 in the outer shell. But if the outer shell, called the valence shell of an atom, only has one electron. Electrons like to stay together with the atom if they have a pair. So if I've got 2 electrons in my valence shell, it's not going to be easy to get this guy to want to leave. But if I can, and certainly if there's more, then it's going to be very, very difficult. But if I have one electron here in the outer shell and the atom is fairly large size, in other words, I've got a good distance between the positively charged nucleus and the negatively charged electron, the further these distances, the attraction between the two comes unbelievably weak. So weak, in fact, that an external energy source just bumping into this atom can cause that electron, because he's eager to leave. It's strange. Can cause that electron to want to leave. And sure enough, in silicone, and there's other substance too out there, when this energy strikes a silicone atom, that's been doped, the silicone, this electron will jump off, which is actually pretty cool. And of course, what's this energy right here? It's a photon. A photon. And remember, photons adhere to what we call the duality principle. I can describe light in terms of waves, or I can describe it in terms of particles. You know, we talk about waves of light. They can be reflected, they can be refracted. I can have combinations of waves. I can have destructive interference, constructive interference, and destructive interference, etc. Or I can talk about light in terms of particles, and like we're doing here when we talk about photons. But this photon strikes the atom and an electron is ejected. And that's what's happening at the atomic level when a photon comes down here, strikes this, I can't remember which one's on top, P-type or N-type, P-dope, N-dope, whatever you want to call it. But a photon comes down, strikes this. Remember, the law of conservation of energy says that energy is neither created or destroyed, it simply changes form. And sure enough, the energy of this photon causes this electron to jump off of that atom, which changes the energy state of that atom. So there's that transfer of energy. And then here are our pixels. Remember, there are these vertical shoe boxes. And sure enough, the shoe box, in fact, I'm just going to draw a single one under here again. Forgive my artistry. I'm going to just draw a rectangle here to rip. And sure enough, the electron that's popped off that particular atom falls down into that pixel. And of course, every time an electron strikes the silicone above that pixel, an electron's popped off and they just collect down in here. And they continue to collect during exposure time. And then once we're done exposing, then the electronics in your camera starts reading the information one at a time from those rows. How it does that real quick, again, knowledge is wonderful, isn't it? Here's my row of pixels. Well, I have a read row down here, and the bottom row of my sensor is dumped down into this read row, transferred down, and that information is read out. Now that this row is empty, all of these others can drop down one, which leaves this top row now empty. Correct? Yes, that is correct. Now that bottom one is read, and then it's sent down the pipeline for processing. Now both of these are empty. And about this time, in most modern day sensors, these pixels now can open their eyes and they're ready to begin collecting data again. And that's one of the things that gives us these really fast frame rates, because if we had to wait, even though this happens in, I don't know, a billionth of a second, I don't know how fast these are read, even though this takes very little time, if we're doing this millions of times a second and we waited until this sensor was completely empty to begin collecting electrons again, that would really reduce our frame rate. So it's pretty cool that once this slides down here and frees up this top row, we can begin to collect data. And this, by the way, is what's called a rolling sensor, and it's probably the most common type of sensor now you'll find in modern day cameras. This effect right here is what causes, for example, an airplane's propeller blade or anything else that's moving fast to look curved. We all know the propeller blade is actually straight, but it looks curved because when that first row of data collected data and saw the propeller blade, and then as that data is moved down and emptied and now allowed to absorb electrons again representing the propeller blade or anything else that's moving fast has moved slightly and just enough to change its position relative to the last row that was read of information related to that propeller. And you see that movement as it's swinging. So it's pretty interesting. It's similar to the effect that you see in car commercials where they're, you know, going down the street kind of at night and it looks like the wheel rims are going backwards. It's similar to that same effect, whereas the frame rate is equal to the sum ordinate value, 1 × 2 × 1/2, 1/4, 1/8, etc., of the RPM of that wheel. And that's what allows you to see that. So this is what's happening in here. is that electron is, I'm sorry, the photon is coming down, popping off an electron and being collected by your pixels. That is the basic operation of your sensor. So now let's talk about how this ties into my CFA, color filter array, or my Bayer. By the way, I hadn't spelled that yet. It's like the aspirin, which I think was invented by a German guy. I can't remember. Bayer. And the guy's name was Bryce. So Bryce Berry worked for Kodak Eastman, by the way, which an engineer for Kodak Eastman is the guy that invented the digital camera. It was a CCD type. It was about, look, this is one of my cases for my, either my cameras or my lenses, but it was about this big, weighed 15 pounds. It took 10 minutes for an exposure. And his staff laughed at him, said, that'll never be anything. And I think he took the design somewhere else and they made money off of it. It's much like the story behind Xerox and the photocopying process. The guy that came up with that worked for Xerox, and I think they laughed at him. It was some company, and maybe he went to Xerox, I can't remember. But that's where the, you know, in the old days when I was younger, we didn't say, hey, make a copy. We said, hey, make a Xerox of that. You know, it was just like Googling. Google is a noun, but yet we use it as a verb. It was the same thing with Xerox. So back to our discussion of a CFA. This sensor, let's talk about, let's look at this pixel here again. Yeah, you know, draw it out. I keep saying, wait. So a photon comes down here, strikes the silicon, and an electron is collected in here. Electrons do not have color information. They do have energy states, but they don't have color information. Whereas your photon does. And what determines the color, even though they physically don't have color, we still talk about the color of photons or the color of light. What determines the color of this light? Well, it's energy state. Or its frequency. They are all synonymous, right? Lower wavelengths have higher energy states. So those are your blues, your ultraviolets, your purples, etc. All the way, and we can continue to move down the electromagnetic spectrum to even higher energy photons, such as X-rays, cosmic rays, etc. And then your weaker ones in the visible light spectrum are your reds, your orange, your yellows. And then we could go either further left on the spectrum and we can get to infrareds. We can get to radio waves and then ultra low frequency radio waves all the way down to the end, lower end of the electromagnetic spectrum. Those are all photons. But the type of photon, or rather how we detect it, whether it's our eyes through instruments, is determined by its energy state. So the colors that we typically see in our range, and it's not that color is limited to this, but we typically talk about, you know, I got to say it myself, Roy G. Biv, we talk about red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, and violet. The color of a photon of our visible light is determined by its energy state. But this electron that gets popped off into our well as it moves down has no idea what that color is, nor does really that photon. It doesn't know that it's a pink, purple, or whatever. Now, there are millions of colors that the human eye can detect. But what's interesting is, just like you learned in art class in grade school, you can generate just about any color you want with your basic primary colors, right? Red, blue, yellow, did I get that right? There are other colors that you can combine to get to all the millions of colors that the human eye can detect. For example, CYMK, cyan, magenta, and yellow. Any mix of those can give you the millions of colors that the human eye can detect. Also, to add to that, a perfect mix of CMYK gives you black, but in the reality, you don't always get that perfect mix. So we actually throw some black in there in the printing process to make those blacks happen and those darks come out. In the world of video, like television and your computer monitor and the old CRT monitors, and in astrophotography, we generally do everything in RGB, red, green, and blue. So we can take any combination of those three colors and generate the several million colors that the human eye can detect. We can generate stuff that the eye can't even detect. In fact, we can combine an equal quantity of those three colors and get black. We can combine none and get white, and then every combination in between that we can see. So the engineers have decided, hey, instead of building a matrix that's got eight different color filters on it in our CFA, let's just build one that's got three. So let's just go with the standard RGB. In fact, when I was a kid, I could go right up to our television, and this is the old CRT, cathode ray tube television, the old big 800 pound television that sat on the living room floor. I could go up to it and look at it very closely, and you couldn't even tell you were looking at a human being, because all you saw were these green, red, and blue little dots, little rectangles actually, to be specific. So it was pretty interesting to go up and see that. So our matrix, and I'm going to draw it out This is our CFA. This is not our sensor. This is our Bayer matrix. And I'm going to draw these squares a little bigger than they normally would be. Consists of an array of filters. And these filters have different colors. So I'm just going to randomly put some colors here. Here's our red. In fact, let's just do this. Here's our blue. And here's our green. And a lot of people go online to watch videos and they want to get the information and leave and don't want to be online too long and don't want to watch a bunch of boring videos. There's a part of me who wants to make these very short, but there's a part of me that says, hey, let's just explain it. And they have the option to either leave, fast forward, watch it later, or, you know, make your significant other drive during the road trip and you can watch movies. But here's our three filters. Now remember, in the world of filters, when we talk about filters, when I talk about a dust filter, the filter prevents the dust from passing through. In astrophotography, when we talk about UV and IR filters, or cut filters is another synonymous term, I am blocking that IR energy. I am blocking that UV energy. In this discussion, in any discussion regarding Bayer matrices, or CFAs, if you want to call it that, again, color filter arrays, when we talk about there being a red filter here, we have to kind of reverse the roles. That means we're allowing red to pass through. Okay, so if we were talking about a UV filter on our scope, we're not letting UV in. But when we talk about color filters, like your color filter wheel, what color, I got an RGB and an L filter for my color wheel. When we talk about color filters, we're almost always talking about allowing that color to come through. So same thing here. We're allowing red to pass through, green to pass through, I'm sorry, blue to pass through, and green to pass through, and nothing else. And nothing else. So if I go back to my kind of my well depth picture of a pixel, and again, no awards for artistry. What the heck? Tell you what, for simplicity, would you all allow me just to do that? So this is the pixel that happens to be underneath the part of the Bayer matrix that has a red filter. Then here comes all of these different colors, and we can describe them in simple terms of RGB. So here comes all these colors down here, and they strike my CFA, my color filter array, but guess what? Only the red gets through. Only the red gets through. And remember, now I have that doped layer of silicon or metallic oxide. There's different forms out there. But remember, now I have that silicon right here, that red photon, because now we know it's only red, strikes that silicon, pops off an electron. Pops off an electron. Of course, that electron gets collected. And as this continues to happen during exposure time, I collect a lot of electrons. Now remember, these electrons don't have color information. Electron does not have color information associated with it. But the mere fact that under this particular coordinate of X, Y on my sensor, I know the CFA over that sensor at coordinate X, Y is a red filter, then I know everything collected in that well at that coordinate is associated with red. So then when I read that line of data off the sensor, I know which parts of that line of information has to do with red information. Same thing here. If there was a green filter right here, then obviously all that would be allowed to pass through is a green photon. It strikes that silicon. Pop, comes an electron, it's collected down in here. So then what I end up with is an array, a sensor. My sensor now, I'm outside in my second garage and I hear cars go by and it's just a natural curiosity to look and see who's passing by. But now I have some red information. You know, I would just leave these caps off. Maybe some green information right here. I've got some blue information up in here, etc. And now I have some color information regarding the data that is coming out of this sensor. It's pretty amazing. And can you imagine without this, how would we ever get nice? Well, I mean, you could get digital pictures, but everything would look like a blizzard in northern Wisconsin, right? Because IR energy, disregard, that's a whole separate conversation. Well, you would collect IR, right? Because these sensors, by the way, are sensitive to IR information. So you'd what would show up in your photograph is heat information, IR information. There'd be no color, right? So something that is a bright green would look a bright white, and then something that's a dark red would just look like a dark, you know, a dark white, you know, a kind of a gray, if you will. And you could look online and see examples of what these pictures would look like. So when this was all invented, so I hope that explains the basic operations of your sensor and the Bayer matrix. When this was invented, they didn't have astrophotography in mind. They just had normal digital color cameras in mind. And they said, you know, what are we doing this for? Well, we're doing it for human beings, right? We're not doing it for cats and birds and dogs. We're doing it for human beings. It just so happens that the design of the eye, your retina, the wavelengths for which your photoreceptors are more reactive to is green. Green wavelengths. Your eye is much more sensitive to green, those wavelengths, than red, blue, or the other colors in the visible light spectrum, which is very interesting because we find green appealing, right? We love green yards and green parks and green trees and green forests. You just kind of wonder if there's an association between the two. But that is what it is. So they said, hey, if we're going to build this matrix, and by the way, the matrix is a two-dimensional array, and any two numbers multiplied comes up with an even number, right? Two even numbers multiplied. Let me take that back. Forget everything you said. In fact, let me edit that out. So because the eye is more sensitive to green, they designed this matrix to have more green filters than the red and blue. In fact, if you look at a breakdown, 50% of your filters on a Bayer matrix are green, and the other remaining 25% and another 25% are for blue. And this is where you get your total of 100%. So the configuration for this, and I'm going to draw a big Bayer matrix on here, will look something like this. You'll have twice as many greens. And you've seen it before. We got R, G, G, B, B, G, R, G. You've different configurations here. What that is describing is the first 2x2 grid in your Bayer matrix. So R, G, G, B is a common one. So that means this is going to be R, red. This is going to be green. Remember I said it describes the first 2x2 array within your matrix. So 2x2. So now we have another. So we did red, we did green. Now we got to do another green. So the way you do this, you come across and come down, green, and now here's your blue. And that is the configuration of your Bayer matrix, RGGB. And for every other 2x2 grid on here, that's the configuration that you have. So we go over one more, and now we get the same configuration. Let me just pop these caps off. I was at a career field in which you use whiteboards and draw erase markers all the time, and man, you get the stuff all over your hands. So we do a repeat here of that, 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 and that. And let's just do one more for purposes of discussion. Let's do one more 2x2 array. Black cap didn't want to come off. One more 2x2 array. Let's put our colors in there. So here's your red, green, green, and now your blue. And that is what your Bayer matrix looks like. That is what your Bayer matrix looks like. And notice if we were to count here, we got 1, 2, 3 reds, 1, 2, 3 blues, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 greens. Again, adhering to our half our total is going to be green, and then the other remaining 25% is going to be blue, and the other remaining 25% is going to be red. And here's our RGGB matrix. If we were to do BGRG, we'd have blue, green, red, green. And you typically don't have greens adjacent to one another. You'll have them diagonally. So this one that I just kind of randomly made up probably isn't a real world one. There's generally four of them out there, and we could go through the iterations of RGB to figure out what they are, but you're not going to have two greens adjacent to one another. So that's how they kind of set these things up. So when you take a raw data, by the way, your camera, your DSLR should be able to take pictures in JPEG or RAW. JPEG stands for Joint Pictures Experts Group, and same with MPEG, Motion Picture Experts Group, a consortium of scientists and smart people that got together and said, hey, we need to standardize how we're going to compress pictures and video, because this technology here can produce colors that the human eye can't even detect. And yet it's a lot of data. So why don't we compress this, take out the colors that the eye can't even detect, mix some other ones here just subtly, so much so that we save a lot of storage space, but the eye can't detect it, and then you end up with JPEG. The problem is, and a lot of that processing is done on the circuitry in your camera. That's why your camera can record JPEG images. But the problem is, it is a lossy algorithm. Lossy means there's a loss of data. And in the world of astrophotography, when you're shooting a 10.0 magnitude, extremely dim object, we don't want to lose information. I don't care whether you're trying to compress it or not. We want every single piece of information about that object, in other words, electron, every single electron that was popped off that silicone wafer, I want, and let me process it and decide whether or not it gets tossed out, not the software or the hardware on the camera circuitry. So that's why we always want to shoot in raw. We always want to shoot in raw, because raw doesn't do any of that process. It gives you the raw data. And because that image hasn't been compressed, like I just talked about, the raw files are what? Bigger, because they contain everything. But we always want to shoot in raw, always want to shoot in raw. And that raw image file isn't just image data, it's data about the type of matrix used in that camera. And so when I send that raw file to my processing software, such as PixInsight, looks at it and goes, oh, this is a RGGB, and now I know how to process, do color information on this this monochrome image. And now it can discern colors. Now, if the image just was simple pixels of red and green only, in other words, red values, green values, blue values, it would be a very, very ugly picture. It'd be a very, very ugly picture. Now let's look at now our sensor. Now that's our bare matrix. That's our bare matrix. Now let's look at a simple sensor. Just a simple sensor. You can probably hear somebody out there cutting the grass. And let's suppose, for example, that our bare matrix, although you'd have an even number, right, in a 2x2 matrix, but I'm going to leave it like this. Suppose we had two electrons associated with green. We've got 8 blue. We've got, you know, maybe one green here, one green there, one blue here. Maybe a red here, a lot of red right there. And by the way, there was no information collected here. Maybe it's a speck of dust. Maybe it's a bad pixel. Maybe it's just something that's black in our image. But we have no information there. And suppose we've got, let's just say, a little bit of blue right here. So this is the information collected on our sensor. So we got 2 electrons associated with green, 1 electron with green, 3, et cetera, right here. So this is our information. If this were the picture that we were looking at, we'd be looking at a bright blue spot with a little bit of blue over here. But because these pixels are adjacent to each other, it's easy for me to go, well, you know, we know that's not pure green. There's probably a little, I mean, there is nothing in the real world that says, hey, here's a green leaf and there's an absolute border between the green leaf and the blue sign in the background, right? We know that's not true. There's always a blend right here. So your software, your processing software, and your camera, if you decide to have your output be JPEG, will take a look at these two pixels right here, this green 1 and the blue 8, and say, you know what? There's probably a little bit of blue information over here. Let's just put a little bit of blue in here. Let's add 3 units of blue on that side. And let's just put about, since there's only a little bit of green adjacent to this very blue pixel, if you want to, let's put about 0.25 green in here. So we end up with a little bit of a mix of blue and green here, and with mostly blue because this 8 is so predominant. But because that green is weak and that 8 is powerful, we only put a little bit of green over here. So after we process that, this pixel is not a pure blue anymore. It is a blend of green and blue. Oh, and by the way, I got some red over here. So now let's add a little bit of 0.25 of red. Oh, I've got some blue here adjacent, so maybe we need to add a little bit blue. Oh, we got some green here, so now we need to add some green. So the effect is this pixel ends up being a combination of not just blue, that was the raw data, again, synonymous with the raw image file format in your camera, but we end up with it. I'm just going to do a little hodgepodge mix of colors there. That pixel actually, now we do some mathematics to the information associated with that pixel, and now it's a blend of different colors. It is a blend of different colors. in my post-processing. And I believe it's one of the most popular algorithms to do this. Is it VNG? That's what it is. And I can't remember what that stands for. Very near grouping. I don't know. You can look it up. But that's and if you look, for example, in PixInsight, I use that. That's why I know that the options in that program. In your debarring process, I can select. There's bipolar interpretation. There's other methods in there. I can choose the method associated with the matrix to determine. And that will drive, by the way, typically the algorithm. You can use an algorithm on a given matrix, but there are algorithms that work better on other matrices. So this is how I take this grid of just red, green, blue, and I create purples and pinks and mauves and beautiful yellows and red roses and mixtures and all that. This is how we get our color information off that, is that we do a mathematical blending of the pictures to make that happen. So let's talk about, obviously that's a color camera, and color cameras have a bare matrix on top of it. If I've got a pixel, like we had earlier, let's just use red as an example. There's our silicone wafer. Here's a little red portion of our bare matrix. Remember, blues and greens that come down here, you know, here's some greens, here's some blues. These guys never get in, right? Only the red. So suppose I'm looking at a nebula that's predominantly blue and green in terms of the spectrum, and very little red. Well, guess what? This particular pixel will collect none of that important blue and important green information. So we lose data. We lose information on here. So suppose I were to take this away, then what do I get? Well, then I get everything. And there's no way for me to tell this pixel, dude, you're only red, or you're only blue, or you're only green, because it's gonna have the whole plethora, you gotta love that word, of data in here. But what if I just take just one filter that covers my whole sensor, like that, just one filter. So every pixel in my sensor now will what? Collect blue information. So all these different photons coming down here. These lids drive me nuts, these caps on these markers. So all these colors that come down right here, only the blues will get through, hit our little silicon wafer, and pop off an electron. Now I get blue electrons in here. And the only information I have lost are my reds and my greens, right? But here's what's cool. After I collect as much blue information as I would like, I just swap this filter. I now take this blue filter, and by the way, I read this information, so all these are gone. My wells are now empty. Now I put a red filter, and now everything that goes through is only red, and now I collect a bunch of red electrons. So I've collected blue information, blue data is what we call it. Now I've got red information. Now I do that for some given amount of exposure time. By the way, now I'm done. So now let's take that. Let's read the information, collect it, store it somewhere. Now my pixels are empty. Now I can come in and put a, what color haven't we done yet? Green filter. And now I collect green electrons. And guess what I have now? I have a file set of just green data. I'm just going to do this in one marker color. Blue data and red data. And every color that struck my sensor during these three exposure times, I didn't lose a single piece of data. I caught it all. Earlier, we talked about the electronics of our sensor and how it is sensitive to things beyond what we can see. For example, infrared. So I could have a filter here that's a green filter, and it only allows green through to include blocking infrared. But then I can put another filter here that only allows the infrared. So no normal visible light spectrum comes through, but just the infrared. And that would be an infrared filter or pass-through filter. Remember, when we talk about color, we allow it to go through. Anything other than visible light color, when we use the term filter, we got to be careful. Are we allowing it to pass or are we blocking it? And that's why oftentimes when we talk about filters associated with non-visible parts of the electromagnetic spectrum, we throw in the term cut, we throw in the term block, you know, so it's an IR blocking filter, or we use the term pass-through or pass. So it's an IR pass filter. In other words, it's allowing IR information to pass through. We pop electrons and now I have infrared information. There's a lot of DSOs out there that are very dim in the visible spectrum. They're not emitting much energy in the visible light spectrum, but man, they are just radiating like crazy in UV or in IR, for example. So we can have a series of different filters here, and that's where our filters come from. When you see online, everybody's talking about these little round filters. I put them in a color wheel. I set up my sequencing software to take, you know, 10 minutes of data in red, and then I stop imaging. I dump the data out of the sensor. I rotate the filter wheel now to the green, open up the sensor's eyeballs, collect data, empty the sensor. Now I rotate the filter wheel, and that's how I can get my RGB data that you'll see. And typically they use another filter just to kind of as a catch-all, right? Kind of as a goalie on a soccer field, kind of a catch-all called the luminance filter. And it's simply collecting, if you will, brightness information, right, in terms of a brightness scale. So, and that's where you get your RGBL, and you'll see that all the time. RGBL or LRGB is another way to put that. So that is your bare matrix. And there's one last thing I'm going to talk about here while we're talking about sensors and things like that. Is because our sensor, and I'm going to just draw this two-dimensional sensor, is sensitive to IR, right? When we take a normal DSLR that I would bring to the park and take pictures of the kids or go to the zoo or pictures of birds on a nature hike or whatever, there is an IR filter, and this is independent of the Bayer matrix. There is an IR filter across my sensor because I don't want IR information to strike that sensor because it will register an electron and it will show up in my picture. So I don't want that IR information. So this is what's considered in the terms of astrophotography, an unmodified DSLR. And there are some DSOs out there and things you can take pictures of that you lose a little bit of IR, right? Because it is a blocking filter, right? We're not allowing IR to go through. This is an unmodified DSLR. But if you want to dedicate a DSLR to astrophotography and gather as much information across the electromagnetic spectrum that that DSO is emitting, then we need to remove that IR filter. And now IR information can come through. And that's awesome because now I get a lot more information about that about that DSO object. And in my filter wheel, by the way, you know, we talk about LRGB, that's four positions. Well, many filter wheels have more than just four filters that they can hold. So I may put an IR filter in there because if I want to collect green data only, I don't want an IR associated photon to work its way to the sensor and pop off electrons. And meanwhile, I think it's associated with green information when it's really IR. There's other forms of light that can be emitted. Remember we talked about elements popping off electrons. Well, also elements, when they absorb energy, either through heat or other photons, well, the electrons in that atom changes orbitals, so it changes energy state. And they don't like that. It's called an excited state. Atoms, like we people, don't like to be excited and in a frenzy. So in about 2 billionths of a second, that electron goes back to its original orbital and to its ground state, chilling out, mellow. But guess what? Law of our conservation of energy says that energy has to go somewhere, and it leaves in the form of a photon. And the energy associated with that photon has to do with the type of element that we're talking about, whose electron changed orbital. So if we're talking about sulfur atom, whose electron changed orbitals and then popped off a photon, that photon can be associated, that energy level associated with that photon is equivalent to the energy level lost by the atom when that electron changed orbital. So I can now tell you that that photon, because of its energy level, is associated with a sulfur atom. Same thing with hydrogen. You know, hydrogen has a single electron, and when that thing changes orbitals from its inner orbital to its outer orbital and then drops back, a hydrogen-related photon is released. Same with oxygen, and all your other elements out there do it too as well. Iron typically does not glow white, but it will glow red, and that's why, because of the energy states associated with the photons ejected by an excited iron atom are red. And so now, how does that tie into some of our other discussions you'll see online? Well, you'll see people use an oxygen, what we call O3 filters, because there's different variations of oxygen based on the orbital configurations and whatnot. In the world of chemistry, we call that, I know the term, just doesn't, I'm not going to waste your time with me standing here trying to remember, but there's O3, sulfur 2, hydrogen alpha, right? Because there's different orbital levels, and one of them's called alpha, right? And so many DSOs emit wavelengths associated with those elements, which means those elements are in that DSO. Helium was discovered in the sun before it was ever discovered on Earth. Why? Because of this concept that I'm talking to you about. In fact, helium was given the name helium based on the Greek god of the sun, who was Helios, and that's how helium, symbol HE in the world of chemistry, got its name. So that's just a great example. So the point of that is that I can put many different types of filters, because this sensor is sensitive to many wavelengths across the electromagnetic spectrum. Cosmic rays. I didn't even talk about that. Cosmic rays is a photon, high energy photon, well beyond what the human eye can detect in terms of energy levels, but this can detect it. So I have a filter over that to block those cosmic rays. There's a great video of a little lander that, and I can't remember, it was a ESA or the Japanese, somebody landed a lander on a comet, and you see all these horizontal streaks. Well, guess what? There's no filters on that camera, and those are cosmic rays, because the solar system is full of them. They come from the sun, right, and other stars out there. Of course, our atmosphere blocks almost all of that, but some still get through, and guess what? This thing can register. That's where your darks and your flats and your biases and all that, what we call calibration frames, can be used to take that information out. Then the very last thing, if I have not bored you to death, I think we're at 51 minutes, almost 52, is that the electronics that I drew for you, which by the way are at the nanometer level, we're talking about billionths of a meter. So we've got, for example, we got a photoelectric diode. This is the actual part that's sensitive to the photos coming in. And when the photons strike that, there's an electrical current that's generated that's only allowed to pass in one direction, that way, not that way. That's the nature of a diode. By the way, this is called the photoelectric the photoelectric concept or whatever, where we can create electrical energy from a photon. And Einstein, as smart as he was and all the things he came up with, he only got the Nobel Prize for science once, and it was photoelectric effect. That's what this is, photoelectric effect. He only got the Nobel Prize for this. But this whole idea, and solar cells work this way too, by the way. So of all this electronics in here, remember, then it comes over here, we've got some AND gates, and then we've got some NAND gates, and I think there's an OR gate in here, and all that. Well, sometimes this stuff goes bad. Sometimes it goes bad. And so on our array of pixels, sometimes you'll get a pixel that's just dead. Doesn't register a thing. Now, when I'm taking pictures of the elephant at the zoo, I will never see that. I could have a lot of dead pixels, and I will never see that. But in astrophotography, it can impact your images, because we're talking about quantities of data that are so minuscule and so small, but we need it to be able to image this DSO. I need every pixel available. Sometimes this thing will lock up and register voltage no matter what happens, even though there's not even an electron in that pixel. When it goes off it, the camera reads that line, it is chock full of electrons. So the camera says, whoa, a lot of data here, brother. And if I happen to have if it happened to be under a green part of the CFA or bare matrix, then there's a lot of completely full of green information in that one pixel. Now, again, a picture of an elephant at the zoo, I would notice that, but in the world of astrophotography, that can greatly impact your image. So, and I can have some that just are so jacked up, they just register as a pure white. Sometimes you see red, and we call those hot pixels. Sometimes you have bad pixels, sometimes you have hot pixels. And that pixel at coordinate x, y is hot no matter what, or bad no matter what I'm imaging. So what I can do is allow no data to get through whatsoever, take a bunch of pictures. By the way, also heat can cause this sensor to pop off electrons. So that's why we have cooled cameras. That's why we want to cool our equipment down as much as possible. And that's why on cold nights, our imagery tends to be a little bit better, because we have more accurate data and we don't have these false reads off this sensor. But that's why we take darks with no light allowed to come through, because any information, if I cover up the camera and take, let's say, 20 dark frames, then I'm collecting information only associated with those bad pixels. Now, when I process my normal raw image files from my DSO, and there's this one pixel that is constantly bad, I know because of my darks, that pixel that is bad in my DSO images at coordinate X, Y, I know that's a bad pixel, and then I can use some calculations to take data information from the surrounding pixels, put that into the bad pixel, and now that bad pixel is no longer a bad pixel. It actually contains, not 100% accurate, because who knows what was really in the DSO at that pixel location, but I can get a pretty darn good close approximation. And that's what happens when we process calibration frames in our imagery. And that's darks, and then we have biases, and we have flats that account for dust and specks and weird things associated with the sensor. And then every optic train, meaning the light as it goes through my tube, bounces off mirrors, it goes through my refractor lenses, and then comes out through the eyepiece, or comes out, you know, through a filter on the camera. That's called the optic train. It is the path through which the light passes. Well, there's weird anomalies too. On every single setup and every single camera combination, the light will do weird things that is not natural, and we could take bias frames, or is it flat? I'm sorry. I do very little calibration frames, because I just don't do it with my Dobsonian. But anyway, so your bias and flats and darks can take out all those weird anomalies to get the purest form, as close to reality as possible, image that represents the target we've been shooting. So I know it's a 56 minute video, and I apologize for the length, but again, I believe that we should all be in the business of learning, whether that's you watching this or me, you know, just doing this video. So if you got comments and things that I got wrong and terminology that I've messed up, please leave it down below. We all should always be in the business of learning. And if we have some information about a particular thing, and there's a group of us that are interested in that thing, then we ought to be in the business of sharing that information. That's the purpose of this video here, is to demystify sensors in the bare matrix and color filters, etc. So if you like this video, please hit thumbs up. You can leave comments and questions below. I like interacting with the people that watch these things, and I would ask you to subscribe. You can look at my channel and see that I got a whole host of a wide varying bits and pieces of information related to science, flying, astrophotography, etc. I even have another channel called Whiteboard Science, which I talk about physics and more science directly related subjects in there too. So if you liked what you saw and the other... So if you liked, I ask you to subscribe and click the like button and leave comments and questions below. Appreciate you watching. Enjoyed spending the afternoon with you. Happy hunting, clear skies, and happy imaging. See you.